Google takes position. You are a jewel, Father Dole. We spoke about some adjectives. Amen? But really, I'm a husband, and I'm a dad. My wife Melanie and I have been married for coming up on 25 years. And the Lord has blessed us with 8 children. And as you can see, they're all boys, except the first 7. You can trust that I'm blessed among women. You remember me when you're rosary. So the Lord has blessed us with these children in our short years of marriage. And as difficult as it is to be away from them this weekend, this Father's Day, they're always with me. They're always praying for this ministry, this work that God has called me to. And they're certainly in prayer for you all and for this great event this week. What a gift. What a gift to be together on Corpus Christi, feast of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus. To be together on Father's Day, we're honoring paternity and fatherhood. To be together to worship as the body of Christ. And people have asked me the last couple of days, what's been my impression with Philippines? This is my first time in your beautiful country. And I tell you, and what's been my impression? And I think that the mass we had this morning with Archbishop Gilbert was perfect. And that it really feels like being part of the body of Christ. Of worshiping with you, of praying with you, whether it was in the English or the Tagalog or the Tagalish, whatever it is, you know, moving through. Just being able to worship together as a body of Christ. And then the song came to me, how beautiful, how beautiful is the body of Christ. That came to my heart, just, this is what it means to be part of a oneness, of a life-giving love and unity that the Archbishop spoke so beautifully about. Well, my message to you today flows straight out of not only the reality of my own family, my beautiful, beloved children, and the ministry, but of this theology of the body. Of not just the ideas and the concepts which are beautiful and are changing and continue to change lives and hearts, but a very specific reality of what it means in the family. And how amongst even the threats and the challenges of our family that Father Joel shared with us, what is it that we can reclaim? What is this original dignity that God calls us back to remind us, to have us a memory, to recall a memory of before the brokenness, of before the sin. Not just in some nostalgia. You know, sometimes we remember things just to feel good about our childhood, or to feel good about our country, or about a song. And nostalgia is okay. But nostalgia doesn't change our lives. It's a real looking back for the sake of what's behind us. But there's another way to remember, there's another way to look back. And that's to equip us to move forward. Is to remember who we really are. To move in our own hearts and remind us of why we're here. To take the universal truths of what's good and true and beautiful, and not to keep them out there, but to draw them into our own heart so that our heart can be set on fire. So that we can experience love and joy. We can experience these things not as ideas and concepts out there, but things that literally move our own heart. You see, there's one thing about ideas, there's another thing about experience. And what pierces through concepts and abstracts, what pierces through pain and sin, is love and joy. But even today, we have to purify, we have to remember, we have to draw out the deepest truths of even these transcendentals of joy and of love. And as we do that, we remember I'm hearing the clicker, Father. We talk about what love is. And it seems strange, but something that's so universal to me, something that's so human, something that every one of us experiences as a human person, we still have to go through and explain what it is. Why? Because there's so many counterfeits. There's so many things that look like love, it feels like love, it seems like it's love, but it ain't love. And as we mature, we start to experience this paradox, and we start to realize that this is not here. There's something more. And in the English language, we have one word for love to describe everything. I love pizza. I love my wife. I love my children, Naomi, Leah, Rachel, Therese, Colette, Veronica, Olivia, and Nathan. I love you. I will love you for the rest of my life. And one word that God is love. To describe everything from pizza to God. We know something's not right. If we go back to the ancient Greeks, this was a culture, this was a people who had such a reverence for the created world. Now they were noble pagans, right? They didn't know Christ. They didn't know the fullness of what God had revealed him because he had not yet revealed it. But even being reverent with creation gives us a wisdom to understand the Creator. To stand and to open and to receive reality as it is gives us a wisdom, literally an understanding and insight into even the most supernatural truth, meaning God himself. So what did these noble pagans come to understand about the human experience of love that you and I can still take down to it? The first Greek word for love is eros, E-R-O-S. And eros is the root word for erotic, it's romantic love. This is the love we feel. This is the love where most of the songs are much about. But what do you know about eros? Eros will come and eros will go. What will be head over heels, falling in love. You know that expression, right? You're minding your own business, walking down the street, and you fall into a pit. You mind your own business, walking through the street, and you fall in love. Love at first sight. The Greeks, like me, know this is a real experience. In fact, they personified this Eros as a god. He must be a god because he's so powerful. And they personified this god as a little buck naked baby with a bow and arrow. Cupid. And this was a god who was just mischievous. And we would have these experiences of love that would come and then they would go. Eros is good. Eros is powerful. It's just not very reliable. The second Greek word for love is philia. P-H-I-L-I-A. You'll recognize that from my city. I'm from Philadelphia. And you might know that the name from Philadelphia is the scene of brotherly love. And philia is a love that is very different from eros. Philia is this self-gift. Friendship is not something you fall into. Nobody says, I fell into friendship. There's no friend at first sight. You have to work to make friends, and you have to work to keep friends. And what is it? It's you coming out of yourself to give something of yourself to someone else, then receiving it and give something of themselves back. It's as simple as a handshake to receive and to give something of yourself back. And depending on how much you give, how well it's received, and how much it's returned, it's the depth of the friendship. But it's a self-gift of receiving and giving of your very person to another. The third Greek word for love helps us understand the love within our families. And the Greeks call this love storge. S-T-O-R-G-E. And storge is a strange word. You don't see it anywhere else. But this is that duty that soldiers would have to fight for their nation. It's a duty that a family would have to be connected. Even when there's no emotion, there's no pledge of friendship, your family, because you share a bond, you share something outside and greater than your individual bond. And as a community, you share this. You have stored it within Couples for Christ, even as you build familia and friendships and sometimes eros and romantic. But there's a duty that binds people together. The Greeks call that love, storge. But it's this fourth Greek word for love that will carry on, not just in this keynote session, but also throughout my breakout and the conversation, this agape love. And I know you've heard that word, agape. Say that with me. A-G-A-P-E. Now, even the Greeks, remember, these are noble pagans who recognize that there's a love that seems to cast a shadow above other loves. Now, we know that all love is good. All love is from God. But not all love is the same. And that's one of those wisdom things that we learn as we mature and as we age. To know what is this love that's here and what is the right response in this love. And this distinctions of love is not meant to get a greater lesson for us today. It's meant for us to help to see that there are distinctions in love that are necessary for us to live a joyful life. That are necessary for us to hear and to live the gospel, the good news. And it's necessary for us to be able to proclaim it in the evangelization to the world. To recognize creation as it is, not just how it ought to be. And this agape love is a love that even the noble Greeks held above these other loves because of what it demands. This agape love is that unconditional love. That unreserved love that doesn't say, here is something of me, here is something of mine for you. Those are good. Because remember, even in family, a friendship, you can have different kinds of friends, amen? You can have neighbors, you can have friends, you can have good friends, you can have best friends. But with agape love, you don't just make a gift, you become. You give and receive as gift. And in our Christian purification, in the perfection, which is really how we as Christians understand everything in the world, just as St. Paul was given that vision from the Lord that nothing is unclean, we are meant to restore to our own senses that everything in this created world was created by God. All is of God. And in that sense, we recognize that we can take even what the noble pagans had received in creation, and we can breathe that Holy Spirit on it, that pneuma, to be able to recognize, really to see again, to know again what it was, not only in the beginning, but its value and dignity that restores and retains even to this day. All for those who believe. All is good for those who are good. And this agape love, our faith, through what Jesus Christ himself has revealed, not only through his immediate passion, but through his entire life, what he revealed about love, helps us to see agape love has four marks to help us to know whether it's true or whether it's one of those counterfeits. This agape love is free. You can't trick it. You can't manipulate it from someone. You can't fake it. Agape love must be freely given and received. This agape love is total. As I said, you're not giving something of yourself. It is becoming the gift. It's free, it's total, and it's faithful. Meaning it's not just an emotion that can come and go like arrows. It's not based on the weather. It's not based on your moods. It's not based on circumstance. It's a pledge of a love that will last. It's faithful. It's free, it's total, it's faithful, and the fourth mark of this love speaks to the truth of the power of love. And whenever we make a gift of ourselves freely and totally and faithfully, by its nature, that love is fruitful. Meaning it bears life first in the lover, the one who makes the gift, and in the beloved, the one who receives the gift. And that life of giving and receiving can also exist on its own. We'll come back to that. But agape love is free and total and faithful and fruitful. And those four powerful marks gives us a faithfulness, a confidence to know that this love is true. We're meant to be masters of love as Christians, as followers of Jesus Christ. Not only in our own lives, but to be able to proclaim it to the world. That's love. The second Joy to Be, J-O-Y-T-O-B. Joy to Be was founded, really, as this coming together, this convening of the beautiful realities of love and joy. And it came to me in prayer about a year ago, after I led the Theology Fund Institute, that much of the work that I had done was really about recalling my own faith life, my own marriage, my own family, what really moves me. What really doesn't just strike me as interesting, but what really makes a profound change in my own life. What I came to was this reality of joy. Joy is something that has to be like love, understood, and distinguished from things like pleasure, and even the newer sense of happiness. But if you're a student of the church, the joy that I'm speaking about is traditionally understood as happiness. But right now, happiness is a whole different meaning. When we speak about joy, particularly as Christians, the Christian joy is not based on emotion. It's not based on circumstance. It's not based on a moment of pleasure or sensuality. Joy is the deep-rooted knowing that we are loved for who we are. Joy is rooted in this knowing that God the Father knows us and loves us. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And He is delighted in us as a son and as a daughter. To be a beloved son or daughter of God the Father invents in us a rootedness, an identity, that allows us not only to see ourselves and to see the world, but literally to be able to put on the eyes of God to see the world as He sees it. Joy is such more deeply understood, because it allows us to even enter through suffering and maintain our joy. It helps us understand how the saints can speak about being tortured and making the joyful proclamation, the joy of being sacrificed for the Lord. And we think that's happiness. We scratch our heads like, you're getting your skin cut off. And you're talking about the joy of the Lord? That can't be emotion. That certainly can't be circumstance. There has to be something deeper that is the font, the spring of a proclamation of joy. And the answer to that is being known and loved as a son or daughter of God the Father. It changes everything. And it turns out that identity of being a son or a daughter allows us to sit, stand, kneel before Papa, before the Father, and ask Him the questions that matter the most. Who am I? Why am I here? What truly brings me joy? What would you have me do? When we ask those questions, like a beloved son or daughter, not as a slave going back to the master saying, what do you want me to do next? Not as someone who just put on another identity, a Christian that says, this is what we're supposed to do. We don't just take the moral law and say, well, if I can follow most of this moral law, I'll qualify to get into heaven. Or worse, if I do all these things, God's going to love me. These are the maturity that we have in the moment of our baptism and confirmation and worship and getting to know in prayer and all these. As we come to know God, we move away from the slave mentality to the son or daughter mentality. And we don't just move it from our heads, we move it from our hearts. And what happens is we move from this constriction, this burden, this yoke of being a slave who's worried about doing everything right so God will love me, to a freedom that only a son or daughter can understand. The way we speak to the Lord, the way we speak to one another, the way we speak to ourselves, these are all reflections of who we think we are, of this identity. Who am I? The second revelation that Christ and God reveals to us, this identity, is also the meaning. Why am I here? Everyone asks this question because we have intellect, we have the ability to reason. And that doesn't just mean figure things out from premise to conclusion. That's beautiful. I should have warned you from the beginning that I am a recovering engineer. I was trained in engineering, I have a bachelor's in mechanical engineering, I have a master's degree in mechanical engineering, I spent 16 years as an engineer, and that's just the way I look at the world. So when I see these beautiful truths, whether they're in poetry or scripture or theology or even in law, I want to understand things. There's this tendency to take things apart, to figure out how they work. Anybody else know that? When you want to know what something is, you just want to take it apart and figure out how it works. And there's nothing wrong with that. That is a beautiful thing. It's just incomplete. Because there's some things that we take apart to figure out how they work. But there's also a whole world of things that we actually have to put together to understand what they mean. Things have to be given their proper context. They have to be given their proper environment. They have to have a proper culture. And culture is one of those words that doesn't just mean food and language and gestures and styles of living. That's part of culture. The deeper meaning of culture speaks to the cultivation of persons. How do we become fully human? How do we become ourselves fully alive? How do we become the best version of ourselves? All of these things speak to a truth about who we are that we have to first receive from our Father. We have to be fathered first before we can father. And this identity and the meaning of our lives, who am I? Why am I here? And the third revelation or remembrance that God wants us to know, our identity, our meaning, and our purpose. Our vocation, our calling. What must I? Now that's not the must I that comes out from outside in. Those are the must I's that have, oh, I gotta get up. I gotta go to work. And we don't like our job. I got it, I got it, I got it. That's not the must I. This is the must I that says, well, if this is who I am, and this is why I am, then how do I live my life to be truly me? And there's a joy that even comes within that of saying, this is who I am, and it will bring the fullest me to its flourishing. This revelation literally is a pulling back of the veil that God wants to do us over time, gently, tenderly, but firmly. His is a call to our hearts. His is never an accusation to our hearts. Whenever we feel that accusation, whenever we feel scared to open ourselves up either to another person or to the person, it's because we've been hurt by the accuser, not by God. Our hearts, our innermost being, that tender place where we are truly who we are, God Himself created for us. And just as tenderly and firmly as He created us, He wants to draw us out to become who we are. And that drawing out in the language, in the Latin, is educare, really, education is not about schooling. It's first and foremost the drawing out to become who we are. As Christians, as disciples of Jesus Christ, as those who believe and who know not just about Christ, but know Christ, this is a good news story. Because it tells us that everything that we see in the world right now had an origin much earlier, had a story that began way before the brokenness. That we can speak clearly and have eyes wide open about every sin and brokenness and hurt and pain and doubt in this world, see everything, but never be set to a sense of despair that says, this is how it's always going to be. There is no more. No. Daddy has given us an awakening. This amnesia, this radical forgetting that sin brought into the world can only be cured by a radical remembering. Where our faith calls them anamnesis. Our word anamnesis means radical remembering. Just as amnesia is a radical forgetting. Say that word with me, anamnesis.
Anamnesis.
It's actually in the liturgy. There's a part of our liturgy that we just prayed in. It's called the remembering anamnesis. So it goes about, that's who I am. This is who you are. And our faith is meant to be this constant anamnesis, this constant revelation, pulling back from the veil for us to see, that is who I am. That is why I'm here. This is what I must do. Why? Because all three of those truths connect us to our Father and connect us to His desire for us. We discover, I should say rediscover as Christians, our origin, our history, and our destiny. Our origin, our history, and our destiny. Too many of us think, for good reason, that our lives begin and end based on our birthday and the day that we die. And as Christians, we're willing to extend that to eternity, to heaven, to say, well, if we do everything right here, then we'll live in heaven forever. But we still have this sense, and I think it's natural, that our existence and everything that we begins with the day that we're born and it ends the day that we die. But as Christians, again, with this radical remembering, with this revelation of pulling back the veil, Father God whispers in our ear to tell us more than what we know. That there's a beginning way before our birthday, just as there's an end way beyond our physical death. And when we can remember this story, it actually moves us just like our own family reunion. Dick Cameron, myself, my father's born in 11, and we had these big family reunions going on. It was just part of my life. We would get in the car, we would drive from New Jersey all the way down to North Carolina, it's about a 12-hour drive. And we'd be down there every year I would meet new customers. Just when I thought I knew everybody, you know, my dad, you know, was such a big spread in the 80s. There were brothers who didn't even grow up with. I see some of you nodding your heads like, yeah, that's what that's like. Which means there were people who were always meeting all growing up. But you know what my great memory growing up in those family reunions, it was fun with the cousins and playing and getting to know other people. But my memories are sitting with my grandfather. My grandfather was a Methodist preacher. And he died when he was 102. Yes. And he could still quote you the Book of James at 100. It's a prayerful memory. But I remember he would tell me stories. And he would tell me stories about when he was a kid. Now this would be like, 1908. 1912, 1913. He would tell stories of him growing up, but he would grab my hand sometimes and he would tell me stories and he could just tell he was back there. But the stories he'd tell me weren't just about his own life, it was about the family. And I can look back now, 40 some odd years later, and say he was being a father to me by sharing this patrimony. By sharing this gift of the family and my connection to the family, what he gave me was a deeper sense of belonging. That I'm part of something bigger than my own life, my own 70 scripture says, more than less. And that connectedness within family is how families keep the great gift from generation to generation. And as the family of God, as a family with God, we too have a Father who whispers into our ears not just the stories of our time, but the stories of generations way before. This is what the Bible is. The Bible, first and foremost, is a family album. This is where we hear the stories, the ancient stories of our great, 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 great grandfathers, our crazy uncles. I mean, we got some crazy relatives in the family of God. The crazy aunts and uncles, who killed who slept with who stole whose wife, whose kid with this family, but then got to, everything is in there. And that story, the scriptures tells more about our wounds and our story that we need to be comfortable telling our own children. But the family album of God begins with God the Father himself. And the very first book of our family album begins where it should be, in the beginning. In the beginning was not law. In the beginning was not commandments. In the beginning was not the you shall not, or not even the list of qualifications to be a good daughter. In the beginning is the beautiful poetry of how things came to be. And in our origin, we take the cue from Jesus Christ, who in this case, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, verse 8, actually much of 19, but 19:8. Jesus is answering the questions of the Pharisees who are challenging him about the question of divorce. And here is a perfectly legitimate and powerful question of the leaders of the faith who are asking, Moses allowed divorce to give us a written decree to dismiss our wives. What do you teach? I don't have time to go into all of the exegesis and the challenge and them trying to undermine our Lord. What I want to focus on is how Jesus answered. See, Moses is the great lawgiver. What do you enslaved teacher to this law given by Moses. And he first affirms what the great lawgiver Moses gave because Christ was there to give it to him. Moses allowed a divorce. Why? For the hardness of your hearts. You weren't ready for the truth. You certainly weren't ready to live the truth. Moses allowed the divorce for the hardness of your hearts. But in the beginning, it was not so. He's doing what every good father does. It says, I understand where you are, but this is not all that there is. And our Lord is clearly referencing this in the beginning of the first two chapters of the first book of our scriptures. He wants to take us back to the beginning when God created everything. And everything he created was good, 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 and very good. And that Genesis 1 and chapter 22 are two different accounts of the same story of creation. I love Genesis 1 and 2. I view it just to remind me, in all the drama of our own culture and our ministry, that this is not what it was in the beginning, and it will not be so in the end. And in this first creation account, we have Genesis chapter 1, which is basically the story of creation in poetry, from God's view to man. And from God's view to man, poetry is the most perfect language to unpack this cosmic union. In the beginning, there was nothing. And the Spirit of God hovered above the waters. And then God said, let there be life. And there was. And we see this creation account from God through to man of separation. Creation through separation. And on the first day, he created the light, and it was good, day one. On the second day, he separates the waters above from the waters below, and it was good, day two. On the third day, he moved the waters below into a basin to reveal the dry land, and it was good, day three. 3 days of creation and separation. Light, dark, waters above and below, water, dry land. Then on days 4, 5, and 6, he goes back to those 3 days created in separation, and he fills them. He's answering the two missing things of the first line of Genesis 1. When the earth was empty and void. Now he's creating the separation, and on days 4, 5, and 6, he fills them. This is why, poetically, on day 4, the sun and the moon and the stars fill the lights that was created on day 1. On day 5, the birds of the air and the beasts of the sea fill the waters above and the waters below from day 2. Then, on day 6, in the morning, the beasts of the field, the cow, and the creepy things fill the dry land that was separated from day 3. Then, in the midst of the 6th day, something profound happens, different, but related to everything in the prior chapters. God almost pauses. He does pause. He says, let us make man in our own image, after our own likeness. In the image and likeness of God, he created them, and he blessed them, and he said, he's faithful and multiplied, giving them dominion over the earth, the birds, and the beasts. God seems to reach into his inner being and create this new creature that more than any other creature is a revelation of him. This creation of God through man reveals the first fundamental truth of our family algorithm. The one that is Christians can become church couple. But we're careful, it can become the foundation of our own personal revelation. We are made in the image and likeness of God. And that meaning, that mystery, that never-ending revelation and unveiling is meant to be the heart of our prayer. The heart of accepting the identity of being the daughter or son of God the Father. We are made in the image and likeness. You are my beloved daughter. are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. From the moment of our baptism, we should come out of that water and the dove should have alighted on our own shoulder. And if we have the ears to hear, we should have heard Papa's voice saying, "You are my beloved Son, my beloved daughter, and I am delighted in you." The second great truth of this original story is that God created us male and female. This is first given in Genesis chapter 1, briefly, but beautifully unpacked in detail in Genesis chapter 2. In Genesis 2, it's the same creation event. The same creation event, but not from God's view of man. Genesis 2 is from man's view to God. And it literally begins on the ground, where the Lord God formed from the clay, the dust, the earth, the body, breathing his spirit into the body. And the poet says, man became a living being. That this body, soul, composite, is a creature unlike anything that has ever existed before. And that God formed this new creature. This new creature awakes. And in the beginning of this poetry of Genesis 2, his name is Adam, dust man, earth man in Hebrew. He's named for how he was created from the dust. God picks him up, puts him into a pleasure park, a paradise. That he has nearly everything he needs, but God then proclaims, for the first time in either creation story, that something is not good. It is not good that man is alone. And I will find a helper, an opposite, an other, fit for you, depending on your translation. And we have this story unfolding with the naming of the animals, with Adam spending this time before God the Father to discover who he is, exercising his dominion by naming the animals. And then God lays him down into that deep sleep. You guys know that story. Lays him down into that deep sleep. Not the sleep that we know of. In a real sense, a new creation. And that other, fit for you, God reaches into Adam to take some of his own life. That's the play on the words. When God reached in and took one of Adam's ribs, to the Hebrew, the Semitic who's hearing that story, when they tell that story, they would have heard that God reached in and took some of Adam's own life, closed him up, formed this new creature. Then God, the Lord God, brought this woman to the man. And Adam, you heard earlier, didn't say, "Hi." Adam sang. Adam sang a song of praise. This one, at last, is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. And I will call her woman, for out of man she came. That was a happy man. And yes, he said, "Whoa, man." And that was just in the beginning. The mystery got even more than it. And Adam now was able to experience what he could not understand, but that God in his wisdom knew that it was not good that he was alone. This isn't about emotion. It's not about loneliness. It's about being able to accept and receive the revelation of who you really are. We're intimately bound up in our identities with the God who created us. And the deepest truth about God, the deepest, most fundamental truth about God, is that he is Father and Son and Holy Spirit. That the Father is God, yes? Is Jesus Christ the Son of God?
Yes.
Is the Holy Spirit God?
Yes.
So the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Spirit is God. How many gods do we believe in? Wait. So the Father is God, the Son is God, but the Holy Spirit is God, but there's only one God. Does anybody really get that? Help me. That's one of those things that God tells you, and you go, okay. I get a kick out of people who don't believe in the Trinity, and they say, "Oh, you Trinitarians, you all made that up." Who would make that up. You make things up that make sense. Father's God, Son's God, Holy Spirit's God, but there's only one God. The head can't wrap itself around that infinity, but the heart can experience it. And the wisdom and the truth of that experience is actually more transcendent than what we can figure out from premise to conclusion. It's not so important to know about as it is to know. And knowledge is first relational before it's an abstract idea. We have to experience and encounter what is good to know good. We have to experience and encounter truth to know it's true. We have to experience and encounter beauty to know beauty. And our Lord here is giving Adam this encounter, and knowing that he comes to discover who he is in relation to his Father, and it happens in the first gaze. Not all of it, but a profound transformation in Adam happens even in the presence of this other. She reveals to him more about himself than he could have revealed on his own. He sees in her not just her as an other, which is enough. He sees in her himself in a new way. I am yours, and you are mine. It's the first real human encounter of love. That's why it has pride and place at the beginning of our family album. That we're not just created from love in some abstract way. We are created for love. We are created to love. Not just as a nice thing to do, but because it's who we are. The third beautiful truth of our origin is that this is a communion, it is a common union, it is a call to love in a life-giving community. It's not just about marriage as an institution. It's not just about sex and sexuality. It is about what those things point to, the greater reality. And the greater truth about God is that his Father, Son, and Holy Spirit and their unity is in this communion. The first real and only real communion. We have a history and a dignity in our origin that we must constantly reclaim. We must constantly remember. We must constantly recognize in order for us even to live and to become who God created us to be. Our history in Christ, we look at Matthew chapter 5. This is the Beatitudes. This is the blessed of them who poor in spirit, for they shall see God. The Beatitudes that Christ gave to us weren't just, for no reason, a set of new rules. It was an invitation, it still is, for us to see all of creation, beginning with ourselves, through the eyes of God. To see and think and know as God knows. But also in Matthew chapter 5, as we move through that, we see the pivotal shift from the law to the heart. The pivotal shift from the things we must do in order to be justified before God to the transformation of our own inner life in order to live as sons and daughters of God's heart. Matthew chapter 5 is a pivotal move to move from the law to the heart. That doesn't, he says in Matthew 5, I have not come to use for one iota of the law, but to fulfill it. This isn't an either or between the law and love. It's a both and. It's bringing together the real truth, goodness, and beauty of our own existence, our own identity, our own meaning, and our own purpose. That's not from the outside in, but from the inside out. is a pivotal chapter in the theology of the body, as an invitation to remember the truth of who we are. This also helps us really to understand Pope Francis and his emphasis not so much on the law, but on the heart. Not so much on the concept, but on the encounter. This emphasis that calls us to serve and to love so that all of this revelation can actually happen to us. To move us from studying, to move us from ideas, to help us experience God. Matthew chapter 5 is in our history now, recognizing all sin, that we are not measured by the sin and brokenness, we're measured by the love that God has for us. And finally, the last is our destiny. We do everything as believers, being firmly rooted in the here and now, being firmly rooted in who we are, with the depth of where we're from, and living with the hope of where we're called to be. We're not so heavenly minded that we're no earthly good. And we're not so earthly rooted that we lose the transcendent reason of who we are and why we're here. We are both and. And with each generation, we gather more wisdom about God, more wisdom about ourselves, and we have more of a dignity and a call to share that with the next generation. This is a solemn duty. But what wraps everything, our origin, our history, our destiny, what wraps everything, our identity, our meaning, our purpose, what makes everything worthwhile is the fullness of joy. Every one of us desires joy. We need that candy bar, not just because it gives us a sugar high, because it tastes good. We want that to last forever. We see somebody, we see something, maybe a house, a car, maybe a girl, maybe a guy, and our heart starts racing. And we want that to last forever. The deepest desires of our heart is that we want love to bring joy eternally.
That's right.
And we're so used to settling for all the things that we get high and come back down, we get high and come back down, we get high and come back down, we think that's life. The promise of Christ, as he said in the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verse 11, he was telling his disciples all the mysteries, and he finally says, I have spoken all these things to you. Why? That my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. It's all about joy. That should move our hearts. That should move why we pray, how we pray, what we pray. It should move how we live, where we live, who we live with, and how we live. It should animate everything. Animate the soul. It should be the inner movement of everything we do. The desire for joy and the certainty of God's promise to give it to us to the full. It's worth every suffering, much more. It's worth every pain. It's worth every effort. It's worth getting up and beginning again when we fall. It's worth recognizing how weak and doubtful and sinful we are and having the courage to take off of our masks, little Mr. Christian, and getting real before God. It's worth approaching God in prayer as a son or a daughter and saying, hey, help me. It's worth receiving the Eucharist of God himself, that we don't make God in ourselves. We can't. We can receive him because he's offered it to us. Himself. And we have the courage to meet, however brave we need to our fathers here and say, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. It's been 1 week since my last confession. I did it again. And then getting back up and you fall again. Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. It's been 1 week since my last confession. I did it again. And not kicking ourselves and hating ourselves and being ashamed. I should have known better. I should have done better. I can't believe I did this. We shouldn't be surprised at all. But you know what? My daddy loves me. And yet, he doesn't want me hurt. He wants me to get up and begin again. But we do it with such a joy, that certainty of knowing that we are loved by God the Father as a son and as a daughter, that we're not shocked by our sins. We should be shocked of how lavishly God forgives us and draws us in, like we do our own children. Your motherhood and your fatherhood reveals more about God than you may have realized. You know, moms and dads, there is nothing that your son or daughter could ever do that would make them not your son or daughter. You are disappointed, you cry, you hate when they're hurt, but there's nothing that can be done that says, oh, you're no longer my son. Would to God we had that certainty with God the Father. Would to God we could walk into the confessional and every moment we could pray with such an openness and such a simplicity and such an ease that the world will see it, that our children will see it, that our families become a place that as husband and wife, we live and struggle with our own sins and our weakness and our brokenness. We learn to love. We begin and begin again. And it is the grace of God's presence in that. It is the struggle that our children see. It's the maturity of our own relationship before God as a father that becomes the greatest and deeper way for our children. That helps them to see in a very encounter what it means to become a son or daughter of God. So good as a unique and unrepeatable person with such in common with other brothers and sisters. This is the family. This is not an institution. This is a school. This is a school that none of us feel equipped and prepared to teach. This is the reality of what it means to be evangelizing first ourselves, then our spouse, and then that drawing into Christ as a husband and a wife, being the drawing in of our own children to their own relationship with Christ. This is about heat. This is about life. This is not about words and riches. We have an origin, a history, and a destiny. And this brings us here at the end to our role of the family. We have a word in our faith, and I have a whole other talk on this and others. There's a word in our faith that's needed to capture everything that the family is called to be and to do. It's not just a role. We don't just have a task. We don't just have a mission, which is beautiful, or a vocation, a calling, or the gift of the family. There's actually a word in our faith, a Latin word, our original language in the church that speaks to this task, role, mission, gift, high honor, given by someone in authority, God, that only we can do, that He is entrusting us to do. And part of that trust carries with it a power and an authority. You see why none of these words fit? What is this gift, this high honor, office, role, mission, vocation that God gives us and then imbues us with His authority to do? The word in our faith is newness. Newness. Say that with me. Newness. It can seem like it's an obscure word, but it's actually a word that was used almost 250 times in the documents of the Second Vatican Council. This word newness in all of its forms is meant to convey and gets lost in translation more than just a task, more than just a mission. This is as if Pope Francis, Pope, the Holy Father, walked through those doors right now. And he passed everybody in this room and he came over to you. And he put his hand on your shoulder. Now everybody's oohing and ahhing and taking selfies, but he came to you, and he put his hand on your shoulder, and he says, I need you to do something for me. What would you do? Absolutely, hold it off. Yeah, what did you need me to do? He says, and whenever anybody asks, you tell them, Pope Francis told you, come on. You walk out of this place like, no. And people say, mind your business. And you say, Pope Francis told me. That's a newness. That's different than a task. And there's a newness in marriage. That's why it's called matrimony. It's a form of newness. It's the newness to motherhood. But you can't have matrimony without patrimony, the newness of fatherhood. And if you take this to prayer, you'll see that this high honor, office, gift, authority given by God to enter into the newness of motherhood. Matrimony is this gathering together, that's what motherhood is, a nurturing life. Patrimony is paternity, it's fatherhood, it's engendering life, and then ensuring the good of that life that you brought into existence. So matrimony and patrimony gather and send. It's a communio and a missio. It's like breathing. You inhale and you exhale. And the newness of the family is this communio of matrimony and this missio of patrimony. And just like breathing, you have to have both. You can't be like, well, I'm more of an inhaler. I'm not really good on exhaling. I like the catechesis, I like tempting. I don't like to evangelize. It's a... And you breathe in order to live. And this newness of the marriage carries into through the newness of the family. And that's not just an idea, it's the way God moves his grace through. But my time is over, but I'm going to leave you with these four things. Here is what our church, in Familiaris Consortio, which is called, actually, the newness of the family in the modern world. Pope John Paul II's document from that council, Synod in 1981. Four things that the family newness must address in a very concrete way. One, form a community of persons. This is everything that I spoke about. Forming a community of persons. This isn't an institution. It's not an organization. It's an organism. An organization is very abstract, concrete, and objective. An organism is very communal and human and living. Two, serve life. We heard that going in our homily today. Right? That love, that is oneness, that gives life. Number three, participate in the development of society. Family is not an isolated union, which you all just model so beautifully. It's meant to serve internally and externally. The family is the fundamental cell of society, another phrase from our faith. And when the cell lives and is healthy, so will the organism be. When the cell is cancerous, the organism is cancerous. And number four, share in the life and the newness of the church. I'm sure you've heard of the phrase, the family is a domestic church. That's not a key phrase. That means we carry with it this newness, this high honor, all this gift, to be the first ones transmitting the faith to our children. First, by how we live. And secondly, what we say. And in the same way, the church is a family of families. The family is a domestic church, and the church is a family of families. It's in interacting one to the other, again, what you want to model so beautifully in Couples for Christ, is meant to be the model of this organism of human formation, of getting drawing out, that begins with the I vow of marriage. It draws to the we of the family. It brings together the weeds of family in order to become what we can on our own. And it all gives life one to the other. Children give life to marriage. Families give life to other families. And the family of families gives life to the church. And the church gives life to the family of families. As the family of families give life to the families. And the families give life to the mother and father. It's a mutual thing. But it's all about children. I want to end with this quote from Amoris Laetitia to that point. The church is a family of families, constantly enriched by the lives of all those domestic churches. In virtue of the sacrament of matrimony, every family becomes, in effect, a good for the church. From this standpoint, reflecting on the interplay between the family and the church will prove a precious gift for the church in our time. This is a lovely quote. The church is good for the family, and the family is good for the church. God's plan for marriage and family is joy. That's a glimpse of the joy in my own family. My girls, and this is the heart of our ministry of joy today. I invite you to learn more about the ministry and the work. You can visit our website, our Facebook page, learn more about that, and I have a free series called Choose Joy, a four-part video series. It's free download right from our website. This is about spreading the message about this great gift that God has offered us in and through our own family. If you're learning more about some CDs and resources that I brought with me, I've only brought a few. It was difficult to bring from the U.S., but our ministry is based heavily on, far firmer on, the generous donation of others. And that donation is a promise that I've made to my donors that I give everything away and ask those who have a heart to be moved to support the ministry for any donation amount. These gifts for the books and CDs are all meant to sow the meaning of the ministry. So I encourage you to come to our website to see some of the resources I'll have, some of them in the workshop sessions, but then also I think during the nice table will be some of those CDs that are available. How beautiful, how beautiful is the body of Christ. Thank you, Noah. God bless you. Thank you.